Good afternoon, everyone. It's a post-lunch session, so obviously the topic is actually not meant for the post-lunch. I should not call it boring, but it's not meant for the post-lunch as such. But okay, I have to talk about it, so we can't do anything, and you have to be interactive about it. So we'll see. I'll try to make it a little bit less boring, but let us see how it interests the audience. And at the outset, I thank the organizers for inviting me for this talk. It's always a pleasure to be at Banaras. So my topic is, like, it's a very vast topic. Like, if we keep on talking about it, we have no end to it, because insulin resistance is something which is being researched all over the world, and we have thousands of literature and studies on it. But it's not possible to cover everything. So what I've tried to do is I've tried to cover a few new things. What I thought is, if I start covering what has been researched from past 50 years or so, it will be too much. So I thought, okay, in the past 2-3 years, whatever new mechanisms have come or whatever new things have come, I'll talk about that. So, you put, excuse me, you put the wrong...
I told them.
So sorry, this is for the debate. This I'll be talking next. The topic is insulin resistance, obesity independent, and the differential tissue response. So that is the topic for the talk now. So if what we have to talk is, like, insulin resistance, differential tissue response, obesity, unrelated or independent insulin resistance in relation to vascular stroke. So as I said, the topic is very vast, very difficult to cover everything, but I've tried to put the few new things which have been there for the past few years or last 2-3 years, whatever new things have come about the obesity independent mechanisms, I've just tried to put it here. So we know that insulin resistance is a major contributor to pathogenesis of type 2. There's nothing new, we all of us know it. And we know that visceral obesity is more correlated to insulin resistance, but there are studies to show that even subcutaneous fat is correlated. And we did one research on PCO patients, and we found that actually it was subcutaneous fat which was correlated with insulin resistance more rather than the visceral fat. So there are data for everything, but visceral fat is more correlated as per the data available with us. And what is insulin resistance actually means? It is a term which is used to signify or specify an impairment of glucose disposal in response to insulin stimulation. However, it is not a very, very straightforward term. It can be misleading when used broadly, because not at all the insulin regulated processes are similarly affected. Not like that if we have insulin resistance, every process will be affected. Some may be affected, some may not be affected. That is why it is a very broad terminology. So we actually call it more of a molecular and a genetic mystery, because some patients may have resistance but still they may not manifest. We see so many patients with severe acanthosis, but their glucose values are absolutely normal. They may have very high insulin levels, they will have very high HOMA-IR, but they will have normal glucose values. So each patient has a different response. So it is not only a straightforward thing as insulin resistance. And it basically refers to the effect of insulin on glucose uptake, metabolism, or storage. And we know that insulin resistance in obesity is manifested by decreased insulin stimulated glucose transport and metabolism in the adipocytes and the skeletal muscles, and by the impaired suppression of the hepatic glucose output. Now, if you see what all factors are there, this, if we know, then we can better understand, because though we are talking obesity independent factors, but there are, all these are interconnected in a way. So if there is a glucotoxicity, if there is a lipotoxicity, we have been discussing this in the previous lectures all throughout, there is impaired or adverse adipokine secretion, there are increased pro-inflammatory cytokines. Now this is very important. Many of the inflammatory diseases, those patients can get insulin resistance because of the increase in the inflammatory markers, the common ones being like interleukin-6 and all. And this leads to impaired insulin signaling in the target tissues, and again it activates the pro-inflammatory pathways. That is how it leads to more of atherogenesis and finally atherosclerosis. And finally, that is how it is related to the stroke and other things. So what happens in the tissue response? So there are also tissue-specific alterations in adipocytes. From obese humans, it is seen that with type 2, IRS1 expression is reduced, resulting in decreased IRS1-associated P13 kinase activity, and IRS2 becomes the main docking protein. But in skeletal muscle, it was seen that type 2 diabetic, they tried to see, and they found that IRS2 and 1, both are normal. But the activity is the activity, which is the kinase activity associated with both the insulin receptor substrates, was found to be abnormal. So basically meaning to say that they may have differential response at different levels. Hyperinsulinemia promotes the adipose tissue inflammation, which has been shown very well in mice. This contributes to the disruption of the metabolic processes like the lipogenesis in the white adipose tissue. Nowadays we are talking a lot about white adipose tissue. And this acute hyperinsulinemia, or the increase in the circulating insulin which is induced by food intake, it promotes the nutrient storage in its major peripheral target tissues, and this happens primarily by stimulating the glucose uptake in the adipose tissue and muscle, glycolysis and glycogen synthesis in the muscle and liver, and lipogenesis in the adipose tissue and liver, and protein synthesis in muscle and the liver. Now, insulin also has a repressive function on the glycogenolysis, lipolysis and protein breakdown. That is why we see that when the patient is deficient, they have more of proteolysis. So, as well as gluconeogenesis and ketogenesis in the liver, it also has a local autocrine effect to promote the beta cell growth and survival, as well as influence its own production and secretion. Addition to these peripheral effects of insulin, insulin may also have a bearing on the energy balance, and it also has an action on the peripheral metabolism. Now, another thing is that insulin resistance at the level of the beta cells, this could play a role in hyperinsulinemia, propagates the hyperinsulinemia. This can lead to obesity, because we say that obesity leads to insulin resistance, but actually it is also the other way around, that if there is hyperinsulinemia, it can also lead to obesity. And this has very well been shown in many of the mouse models actually. And also the circulating nutrients also affect the insulin levels, like certain amino acids, fatty acids, sex hormones, melatonin, even leptin, growth hormone, all these can affect. And it can also be tempered through stimulation or repression of its secretion, which we talked about just now. And it is also subject to some modulation at the transcription level at the and also on the messenger RNA stability. So we have all the differential actions at the different, which I talked about. It's not wise to go into the details of it, because we have all studied this for the past 2 days, that insulin has varied actions at different places. So we know that it has action at the muscle, at the liver, at the brain. There are different at the fat tissue, at the adipose cell. There are different levels at which it acts. So is there any evidence for obesity independent insulin resistance? Yes, there is. The first thought of it came initially when they found, or also in that other patients with insulin resistance, but they found this in patients with PCO, that insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia, though caused by obesity, but they may also have insulin resistance independent of obesity. Then people started researching that, yeah, this could be some different mechanism by which insulin resistance is happening rather than by obesity per se. So first thing which we know is inflammation, which I talked in the beginning, that if there is an increased level of inflammatory markers like C-reactive protein, they can increase the insulin resistance. So we know that any inflammatory disease like rheumatoid arthritis and all those patients, they present with more atherosclerosis, they may present with more insulin resistance. So that's why this is important. In skeletal muscles, there can be various abnormalities, including the defective glucose transport, which may cause insulin resistance. And CRP definitely has been shown to predict the development of diabetes in many of the studies. Now, this is the HOMEOBOX high mobility group box 1 gene. This is a non-histone nuclear protein which regulates the gene expression. Now, this can trigger the inflammatory response. So this is one factor which can actually trigger the inflammatory response and can cause insulin resistance. Not that obesity has to trigger it. It can trigger it by itself, by causing inflammation increase. So this could have a role in inflammation, or adipose tissue inflammation, can have a role in insulin resistance also, and islet dysfunction. Now, there is another one, which is the angiopoietin-like 4 in the rheumatoid arthritis patient. This was again studied in patients with RA, and this also explains, it is not only just the simple CRP and other things, there are other factors which are released because of inflammation which can propagate the insulin resistance further. Now, even the nocturnal oxyhemoglobin desaturation can also predict the severity of insulin resistance. We know that patients with obstructive sleep apnea, even if some patients may have, most of the patients will have obesity, but some of them are not very obese, they may still have OSA. So those patients, these could be the reasons which can independently predict or propagate the insulin resistance rather than the obesity per se causing it. Then this was one new just recent thing which had come, so I thought it is for the benefit of the audience. It's a novel adipokine which they have discovered, which is the progranulin, which has been postulated to mediate the adipose insulin resistance, and it is not directly related to obesity, not like that the patient has to be obese to manifest it or to get it. Patient may not be obese, they have studied and they found even the non-obese patients might have it and they may have a predisposition. So that is the factor which comes into play is also the genes and the other environmental agents which propagate and cause the problems. Because many patients may have the genes but they may not develop it actually. Then interleukin-6 and myeloperoxidase have been found to be associated with insulin resistance in impaired fasting glucose subjects. This study was also very just recently published. It's going to come in the next issue. This is a March 2017 is going to come. So they have found this myeloperoxidase and interleukin-6. So as I was talking about inflammation, so this is what it is. And they said that this has a role in inflammation leading to oxidative stress, leading to insulin resistance. So these are the things which can also cause. Now important thing we have been talking about since morning, vitamin D. We know that still we are not sure whether it is the culprit or it is not. But it has been studied in almost every endocrinological disease as such, as of now, and all the other diseases also, not only endocrinology. And we know that vitamin D has been shown to retard the progression from pre-diabetes to type 2, but there are lots of other confounding factors. But this is our data which is there, and we know that vitamin D is also one of the incriminating agents which can on its own propagate the insulin resistance. Now, this chemerin levels are all, they are actually associated with the visceral adiposity, so it is not actually an obesity independent mechanism, but sometimes it has been seen that patients look to be thin, they may have more visceral obesity, especially the Asians, and this could also be one of the things which can be the reason for the insulin resistance, though it is in a way little bit connected to adiposity only. Then lactoferrin. This also has been found to be associated with insulin resistance. These are all the independent mechanisms I'm trying to tell, because my topic covers independent mechanisms. I'm not covering the garden variety of the dependent insulin resistance mechanisms. So lactoferrin, it is an important protein which is found on the mucosal surface within the neutrophils and the various cells and also in the biological fluids. It has multiple functions including the iron binding as well as antimicrobial, immunomodulatory and anti-inflammatory. Now you see this is again the inflammation which has come here. So in a way it has again come to the same place. So it also has these anti-inflammatory activities and this has been also suggested to cause adiposity reduction. So it has a role with insulin resistance and also it has a role with reduction of the obesity, or it is also correlated with obesity. Now this was one recent thing which I saw just in this month it has come. They said that they found that the extracellular RNAs were associated with the insulin resistance, of which 16 were the microRNAs, and this was associated with insulin resistance independently as well as with the regional adiposity. So not that adiposity only caused it, it was some other factor which was leading to it. Now not the least, this everybody is talking and we know there is a lot of research going on, the gut microbiota. So even if the patient is not obese and there is a change in the gut microbiota, they may have propagation towards insulin resistance. The common example we have with the artificial sweetener data which has come in Nature, that the patients who have non-diabetics who consume artificial sweeteners, they may have the change in the gut microbiota because of that, and those patients actually may develop insulin resistance instead of preventing it, because we are seeing so many ads nowadays that non-diabetics should consume artificial sweeteners to prevent weight gain, which is absolutely a wrong notion being told to public. So this is what one of the mechanisms I am saying. Gut microbiota can be altered by antibiotics, by many other reasons, but I just gave an example. So this is the lipopolysaccharide from the intestinal flora bacteria can induce again a subclinical inflammatory process, obesity also. This plus these two together can propagate the insulin resistance, and all other mechanisms also include the effects of bile acids and branch chain amino acids and some other lesser known factors. Metabolic syndrome, why I've talked about it here, because we also are trying to correlate in this topic insulin resistance with vascular stroke. As I said, it is too vast a topic. If I start talking about stroke, it will be too much. So what I've done is I've just put a bit of it. So we know that skeletal muscle lipotoxicity in insulin resistance and type 2, is it a correlation or it is just an innocent bystander? We still don't know it. Arterial stiffening. So key metabolic abnormality we know which occurs in type 2 is the arterial stiffening. First, what happens is this. So that happens because of hyperglycemia and insulin resistance. And the two main pathological processes happen in the vascular wall that elicit the CV events which further leads to atherosclerosis. So this is how the propagation of the events happen. So arterial stiffening is actually the degenerative change of the extracellular matrix which happens in the media layer, and it is little bit distinct from atherosclerosis. And this involves the intima layer, and it is characterized by lipid accumulation, inflammatory cell infiltration. Again, the inflammation comes here, the vascular smooth muscle cells, and foam cell development. So this can cause, plus the insulin resistance propagates it, plus the loss of insulin action in macrophages may also affect the atherosclerosis progression. So it's not only the stroke, it's the other coronary artery events also which can happen by increasing the expression of the CD36 or scavenger receptor A, leading to the increased uptake of the modified lipoprotein, or by inhibiting the pro-inflammatory activation. So this further promotes the necrotic tissue formation in the atherosclerotic plaques, and this enhances the, by enhancing the macrophage apoptosis. So as I said, I'll keep my talk short. So basically what I've tried to cover is, I've tried to cover the obesity independent mechanisms. I'm just trying to show you the new things which have come up. The predominant we should know is the inflammation. We should know about the gut microbiota, because these are the upcoming things which are being talked about. There are a lot of other small factors and small markers or adipokines which have come up, but they are all in the research phase and research is going on. So we know that the main pathophysiology is definitely obesity, but chronic inflammation does play a role. And there is a data to suggest that hyperglycemia and insulin resistance together, they trigger the structural and the functional changes in the arterial wall, which can contribute first to arterial stiffening and later on to atherosclerosis. That is how the process starts. And we know that impaired glucose tolerance and vascular markers of atherosclerosis, if we correlate, it suggests that hyperglycemia plus or minus the insulin resistance per se had only a minor impact on the atherosclerotic process compared to the traditional risk factor. So we don't know whether this is the only factor, because we know that there are so much of the thing, hyperglycemia prevention may not finally prevent the cardiovascular thing in the future, but we don't know. We still are working on that. We still don't have the 100% evidence for that.